And
Okay.
here we go. There we go, Murat, and over to you.
Okay, thank you very much for the nice introduction. So yeah, as Matt said, I've been working as a research fellow with Dr. Matt and Professor Hook. So I've been focusing on multi-waveform multistatic radar networks. And actually, as a performance metrics, we have investigated chromaral lower bands on range and velocity estimations. So firstly, if you look at the outline of this presentation, so firstly, I will talk about chromaral lower bands on range and velocity estimations in multiband multistatic radar networks. And then in a multistatic radar network, we consider DVB-T, DAB, and FM radio signals, which are broadcasted by the respective stations. And also we have an active radar transmitter, which transmits LFM waveform. And based on the bistatic chromaral lower bands information, how we can select the best pairs for range and velocity estimations. So let's start with monostatic ambiguity function, because actually chromaral lower bands is a function of ambiguity function. That's why, I mean, it includes SNR in addition to waveform parameters are given here. So this is the ambiguity function, actually monostatic ambiguity function of a waveform U, maybe given here. So this is actually quite well known by everyone. So let's look at some example waveforms such as LFM and OFDM waveforms. So you can see the LFM waveform here, and it has, of course, uniform frequency distribution. That's why it is frequency spectrum is quite uniform. And if you look at the OFDM, which is also used for radar sensing in addition to communication. Of course, it is mainly developed for communication applications, especially modern communication systems, to overcome multipath fading or channel estimation problems. And look, you can see here, it is content very over the time because it transmits data. That's why its frequency response is also changing in terms of amplitude. And if we look at their ambiguity functions, we can see LFM has a quite uniform ambiguity function, and actually lower side lobes, like less than minus 20 dB in zero Doppler cut and zero delay cut. And if we look at the ambiguity function of OFDM waveform, where we will see like quite high actually side lobes compared to LFM waveform. And also the side lobes aren't decreasing. You can see sometimes there are some spikes, which is again related to data transmitted through the, in the OFDM waveform. So if you look at the chromaral lower band, so firstly, what is, so like these are just the two waveforms that can be considered for radar sensing. So if you look at the chromaral lower bands of a waveform, so firstly, chromaral lower bands define lower bounds of the variance of any unbiased estimator. Therefore, it is commonly used as a benchmark for various estimation technique studies. For example, in one of the studies, which was published in 2020 in IEEE Transactions on Signal Processing. And here, they proposed two different estimation algorithms, which are called alternating projection maximum likelihood. It has a very high complexity, and another one is expectation maximization algorithm, so which has a reduced complexity. So actually, it is quite well known that maximum likelihood estimators usually have quite high complexity because it has to process or it has to try all possible solutions. That's why. And so actually here, what I mean exactly is, you can see in these figures, so they use the chromaral lower bounds as a bound for these different estimators. And you can see actually the, all of the estimators have like a lower estimation errors than chromaral lower bounds. Here, there is something happening. I don't know why exactly, but this estimator provides slightly lower estimation errors than the chromaral lower bounds. However, you can see generally, all of the estimators actually have higher estimation errors, which is higher estimation errors than the lower bound, which is defined by the Kramer-Allor bounds. So first figure for range estimation, and another one for the velocity estimation. So that's why we have constant Kramer-Allor bounds as a benchmark in a multistatic radar network. So, however, so if you look at the monostatic Kramer-Allor bounds on range and velocity estimation for a waveform, then you will see it is a function of SNR or SANR, depending on how we consider, and also the waveform-related parameters. So these parameters are actually related to ambiguity function. So, so ambiguity function here defined as x tau v. And then you can see this function is used in this matrix, which is called Fisher information matrix. So the, for example, it is derivation with respect to square of the delay or delay times velocity. I mean, delay times Doppler shift actually. And also the, again, the Doppler shift times delay. And then it is a derivative with respect to Doppler shift square. So then after finding this Fisher information matrix, and then it is multiplied by SNR or minus two SNR here. And then after finding this matrix, then we can find actually Kramer-Allor bounds on delay and Doppler shift by taking this inverse and then taking like the first element of this matrix and the last element. So this is for the monostatic case. So if we have a monostatic radar, which has transmitter and a receiver located in the same place, then this can apply. So let's look at the monostatic. Sorry, a bit faster. Okay, let's look at the monostatic Fisher information matrix or Kramer-Allor bounds of different waveforms. So this is given for LFM waveform in this paper, which was published in 2011 by Greco and Stinko. So you can see the each element of matrix are a function of different parameters of the waveform. So these are pulse duration, bandwidth, pulse repetition duration, number of pulses, and SNR or SNR. So here, this is for burst, LFM burst pulses, which means it includes, let's say, 64 pulses or 128 pulses for estimation. And then we can also calculate this one for FM radio signal. So this was also given in another paper, which was written by Stinko and Tori. And then actually here for FM radio signals, as you know, it is content varies over time because it transmits an information and it's actually a kind of analog modulation technique. That's why it is highly dependent on the content. Even it is like the bandwidth changing over time. This is why they considered a kind of modified Fisher information matrix here. So they just model the FM signals like by a simple model, which consists beta and the BC parameters. And also then we have an observation time and SNR and also phase of the signal. Actually phase isn't very important in this calculation. So you can see again, we can use this equation to calculate monostatic Fisher information matrix, or by taking inverse of this matrix, we can find the Kramer-Allor bounds. And then this modified Fisher information matrix was also calculated for OFDM waveform. So this is the analytical expression of this waveform for, I mean, this matrix for OFDM waveform. And as you know, OFDM waveform has many subcarriers, and also it is usually filtered by a roll-off filter. I mean, the root-raised cosine filter. And also it has different number of subcarriers depending on which system we consider. So based on these parameters, the monostatic Fisher information matrix of the OFDM waveform was given in this paper, which was published in 2016. So they actually considered L-band digital ironical communication system, but this system uses OFDM, and also DVB-T or DAB system uses OFDM as well. So this can be applied into those systems. Just we need to be careful with the OFDM parameters such as symbol duration, subcarrier spacing, or roll-off factor, filter roll-off factor, or the window duration are different, of course, and number of subcarriers. However, this can be used for different OFDM waveforms as well. So then after giving the Fisher information matrix of different waveforms, now I can actually give a table which shows here which waveforms are constant with which parameters. So for example, FM radio signals, it's called sinusoidal frequency modulation, and the carrier frequency is 100 megahertz, and the bandwidth is 75 kilohertz. Of course, this can have a bandwidth between 50 to 200 kilohertz, depending on the content, but just average bandwidth. And the observation duration of this signal for passive sensing is 100 milliseconds. The power of transmitter or the FM radio station is 20 kilowatts, and the gain of the antenna. So here, I have given the antenna gain as a total gain of the transmitter and receiver antenna. So for broadcasting signals, we can consider omnidirectional antennas. So that's why the gain is like total gain is around 4 dBi. And for the radar chirp, which is an active radar, you can consider. So as it has very high frequency, carrier frequency 9.4 gigahertz, we can have very small antennas, which means we can employ an antenna array. So the gain could be up to 25 dBi, even higher than that one. So for each antenna, so I mean for transmitter or receiver antennas, so the total gain will be around 50 dBi. So other parameters are given here. For example, for DVB-T, we consider 500 megahertz carrier frequency because it is carrier frequency in this range. And for DAB, the carrier frequency is 150 megahertz. And the bandwidth of these two signals are actually quite, actually quite constant because they have some standards. So for example, this is written according to 8K DVB-T standard, and the number of subcarriers is 6,816, and the subcarrier spacing is around 1 kilohertz. And for the DAB, so we have a narrower bandwidth and also less subcarriers. However, it is a subcarrier spacing is higher because probably it doesn't need to, because it doesn't need to transmit very high data speed. So after giving them and the observation time of this waveform. So 64 symbols are observed for passive sensing with DVB-T and DAB signals, and the radar chirp is considered to consist of 64 pulses, and which is transmitted in around 25 milliseconds. So based on these parameters, as you remember, I have given the monostatic Fisher information matrix, and using those information and these parameters, we can actually sketch the monostatic Kramer-Rao lower bounds of these waveforms in this table as a function of, in these figures, as a function of SANR. So you can see for range and velocity. So firstly, for range, you can see the LFM waveform performs much better, which is expected because it is bandwidth is very high, so which is 50 megahertz compared to others. And also, of course, when the SNR increases, of course, the estimation performance or the number of, or the error decreases, you can see here, which is also translated as a lower Kramer-Rao lower bounds. Here you can see. And for velocity estimation, actually, this is main related to observation time, and also, of course, waveform itself. And for example, here you can see FM radio signals can be used for velocity estimation quite efficiently. While it may not be enough for range estimation, you can see you will have lots of errors probably if you use this waveform for range estimation. So, and then this is what we considered as a multistatic radar network. You can see we have multiple transmitters. Some of them are radar transmitter, for example, one of them is FM transmitter, another one is DVB-T transmitter. And we consider two different receivers, which can receive the signals from all of the transmitters. So which means each radar receiver actually can process the signals from all transmitters. Of course, they will need a reference antenna for passive sensing, because if we consider the like broadcasting signals for sensing, then we need to acquire those signals with a kind of like the direct path or line of sight antenna to be able to compare what we received from the target to estimate the range or the rest parameters or to detect the target. So just as a quick note here, so for example, in the reference signal, we will have the transmitted signal plus noise. And of course, also we will have some path loss here. I just didn't show this one here. And for the surveillance channel, which will have direct path interference, because not only the reference signal, but also this surveillance antenna will receive the direct path signal from the transmit antenna. And also it might be actually stronger than the echoes. So then the echo or the return from the target and noise. So in this study, we considered that the noise in the surveillance channel and the reference channel are the same, or they have the same noise variance, because they probably, these two antennas will have this very similar receiver design, or exactly the same receiver design for each waveform. And here, actually, there are two things that can improve the estimation performance. One of them, if we can cancel the noise in the reference signal. For this one, there are some methods in the literature. They demodulate the received reference signal and then reconstruct it by modulating again, because, for example, for DVB-T, it is possible to know the structure of the modulation and demodulation, so it can be possible. However, this may not work well if the SNR is very low, because in that case, actually, there will be lots of estimation errors during the demodulation of the signal. And for the surveillance channel, if we can cancel this direct path interference, if we can cancel this interference, then the estimation performance will be very good, because otherwise this will be seen as a like static target in the radar image. So then, I've been talking about, of course, multistatic radar network. So in this case, for example, there are many transmitters or receivers, as I explained here. So for example, there would be a kind of bistatic geometry between, let's say, this transmitter and this receiver, you can see. So actually this is different than what we or how we estimate using a monostatic radar, where the transmitter and the receiver are located in the same place. So the radar return will be received and they can be processed directly. However, if it is a bistatic geometry, then we will actually estimate the bistatic range of the target and bistatic velocity. So with regard to the bistatic geometry, so you can see here, we have a bistatic bisector between them, and actually all estimations is a relative estimation for this bistatic pair. So as we know, actually I have given the monostatic Kramer-Rallour bounds or Fisher information matrix. If we try to calculate the Kramer-Rallour bounds in this kind of bistatic network, then actually we will see the impact of the geometry here. So in this paper, they have calculated, or they have derived these bistatic Kramer-Rallour bounds, and then they show that actually these bistatic Kramer-Rallour bounds can be written or can be decoupled in geometry related and waveform related parameters. So these are the expressions or the derivations which are used in the Fisher information matrix, as in the monostatic case. Here we have also a Fisher information matrix. Now we need to calculate these parameters, and you can see actually, for example, the so this is again the waveform itself. Of course, here now we have bistatic ambiguity function instead of monostatic ambiguity function, And we have the derivative of this one with respect to bistatic range now. So then this actually can be written as a function of waveform-related parameters, as given here J0, and also the geometry-related parameters. So the more information about this one can be found in this paper picture. So I don't want to go through all of them because there are actually more equations to explain all of them. So after finding them, as you remember, I have given the monostatic Fisher information matrix of all of these waveforms. So we can just implement, or we can just substitute that parameters here in this function. So then we have created our multistatic radar network, which have multiple transmitters and receivers. And now we can calculate the bistatic Kramer-Rohler bounds of different pairs at the same time, with regard to target location, of course, because as you can see here, if I change the location of the target, then the geometry parameters will be completely different. So we need to calculate the bistatic Kramer-Rohler bounds again for each target location. So in the multistatic radar network, we considered four different transmitters, which are LFM, DVB-T, FM, and DAB, actually, this is actually quite usual, because in most actual implementation studies, they have shown that one receiver can actually have multiple antennas to receive these different signals at the same time. So, and then even they have implemented some mobile receivers. So like, for example, on a minivan, so that they can just carry it around the surveillance area to estimate different targets or according to what they want to estimate. And so here we consider two different receivers. And to simplify these analyses, we consider that the direct path interference is canceled, and the noise in the reference channel and surveillance channel are to be same here, or do they have the same noise variance. Of course, they are random. However, the day of power at least are the same. So after that, I can just give some results now, I think, after in this model. So here you can see we have two different receivers, which are placed here, receiver two and receiver one here. And we have different transmitters. So this is the active radar transmitter, which transmits LFM waveform. So actually you can see these two pairs will behave like a kind of monostatic radar here, because they're very close to each other. Relatively, you can see. And the other transmitters are around here. So these are the broadcasting stations. So this one is DVB-T, and here this one is DAB, and this one is FM transmitter. So, and we have a target here. You can see the target starts from this point, and it moves forward along the x-axis here, from 0 to say 60 kilometer range, or 0 to 60 kilometer exposition, let's say. So then in this station, we have calculated SNR at the receiver. So because, as you know, we have four transmitters and two pairs, we will have in total 8 different transmitter receiver pairs. So which means actually we have 8 different measurements of the target at the same time. So these are the SNR. You can see that as the target moves along the x-axis, the SNR of the pairs will change, because the target will cross different points, and in some points, for example, it might be very close to one of the transmitter or receiver, and then it might approach another transmitter or receiver. So the SNR will change. You can see here, it is changing. However, there are a few observations here. One of the observations, you can see these two ones are the FM transmitters with receiver one and receiver two. They have the highest SNR because the FM signals have very low carrier frequency. And also its bandwidth is very low, which means it encounters lower path loss and also lower noise at the receiver. However, for example, for another one, let's say these blue lines represent the active radar transmitter, and it is carrier frequency is 10 gigahertz, and also the bandwidth is 50 megahertz. That's why you can see the SNR obtained from this transmitter is very low. So now we can have a look at the camera low bands on range and velocity of these different pairs. So you can see the this one is the active radar transmitter. When the target is crossing this active radar transmitter or the quasi monostatic pair, it can estimate actually the range and velocity quite well. However, when the target is very far from that one, you can see the passive radar might provide better estimation than that one for range and velocity. And actually here we can see that the estimation of range and velocity are quite different from each other. So for example, this DAB transmitter and the receiver one might provide better range estimation here. However, it may not provide better velocity estimation than active radar transmitter or FM transmitter. So actually we can select different pairs for best estimation for range and velocity, or we can use different pairs actually for different estimations because we will collect all of those data from different pairs. And here there is one observation actually. You can see there are some peaks in this camera lower bounds, for example, here and here. So these are actually here at this point, the estimation accuracy of this pair is quite worse, actually the worst. And here you can see like it's more than like 10 kilometer error might be seen. And here as well, like a nearly 1 kilometer velocity estimation error can be seen. Because at those points actually, target crosses the baseline of the pair, bistatic pair. So let's say, let's consider these two transmitter and receiver. If the target is here, you can see it will be exactly in the middle of them. So the estimation will be quite problematic at this point because of the geometry. So this is called forward scatter in radar studies. Actually, you can see the estimation will be quite worse at this point. And also, for example, after a while, the target might be the baseline of two different pairs, for example, this one here. So the camera lower bounds of this pair will increase here, which means that we will have lots of estimation errors. So then we can have a look at another scenario. Let's say the our target has this kind of trajectory now. Of course, the everything will change here. You can see now another pair might provide better estimation for range at a specific point. And also it might be different for velocity estimation. So actually you can see the area, depending on the location of the target, we might have see that different pairs might provide the best estimation depending on target location. So these are the average camera lower bounds for two different scenarios or the target path. You can see here, we have actually one of them is the combination of all of them. If we combine all of those information by selecting the minimum camera lower bounds, which provide the best estimation, you can see actually we can achieve a very good range and velocity estimations in both scenarios. However, if we just consider one of the pair, for example, let's say this one, TX3 RX2 FM transmitter, actually, it might have overall quite worse performance. Or if we combine the only passive pairs, which means we don't consider the active radar transmitter here, so this is given here. And given here, you can say actually, if it is possible, if this is possible, then actually we can still estimate the target quite well in the area of interest. So after this one, I want to show some other figures. For example, this is the camera lower bounds of the entire area by selecting the best pairs for each target location. So you can see that I have the area of interest here. And this area is sliced into 1 times 1 kilometer observation areas. And in each area, we selected the best pair, which provides the lowest estimation error for range. So actually this also shows the best possible estimation or lowest estimation errors of the of the area for range. Also, this, so if you look at the, you know, the each pair separately, you can see, for example, so I need to actually explain one thing here. So in this actually figure, we didn't consider active pair. So here it's only this only considers passive pairs. So which means the, we have only DVB-T, FM, and DAB transmitters and two receivers in the area. To show how we can perform this sensing or what kind of estimation accuracy we can achieve using only the passive sensing here. So if you look at their like the performance, I mean their single performance, the performance of each pair separately. So you can see, for example, this pair, which is the FM radio transmitter with receiver one, which actually has quite worse range estimation in most areas. So you can see the error is more than 800 in most areas. Only it might be good around the transmitter or receiver. I guess this is caused by the SNR, very high SNR at that point. So DVB-T actually provides better estimation performance, and DAB also can be used. And so this is the same performance with the other receiver, again with three different broadcasting stations for range. And then we can do the same thing for velocity estimation as well. So this is the possible lowest estimation errors or the lowest chromatic lower bounds of the entire area with passive sensing. And if you look at them separately, actually here, for example, you can see FM radio actually can provide quite good velocity estimation depending on the observation duration. So if we have a good observation duration, then actually we can estimate the target velocity quite well. And in this area, actually, there is one thing very, very significant. So for example, in this part, you can see between these two transmitter and receiver, or between this transmitter and receiver pair, you can see the estimation errors is quite worse here. This is because of the bistatic geometry. So when the target approaches the baseline of these two pairs, the estimation errors are quite high. It is seen actually in all of the pairs. You can see here. We don't see this one here because I limited the range, I mean estimation range up to 800. So that's why it has already very poor estimation. So we don't see this active. However, it happens here as well. So here as well, we can see this forward scatter station. And here as well, we can see this one. And it is also seen in the velocity estimation as well. So that's why actually it is important to consider multiple transmitters, especially for bistatic or multistatic sensing. So when we combine all of them, those, you know, the forward scatter or forward scatter station can be covered by another transmitter or receiver pair. So you can see here, actually, we don't have like very low estimation. Very high estimation errors in this area, because if this pair has a forward scatter, then another pair can cover that area for estimation. Of course, for this one, we need to know the geometry, and also we need to know the location of transmitters and receivers, which is actually quite easy because we know that the broadcasting stations are fixed. So let's say DVB-T, DAB on FM or FM stations are fixed in a location, and the receivers are actually are our receivers. So we know their locations. So we can calculate this information for an area if we know the location of them. And of course, there might be some other factors in a real environment. For example, the buildings or let's say the surface of the ground. However, just as an initial study, we can calculate them and then we can select the best pairs for any location. So then I have another figure here. So this is for a larger area of interest. And so this is the combined or the best estimation accuracies. And here which this figure shows that which pairs should be selected to achieve this estimation accuracy for range. So you can see depending on the target location, for example, this pair, which is a TX4, RX2, should be selected around this area. And then another pair should be selected in this area. And for example, in this area, it is better to select TX2, RX1. And we can also do this one for the velocity estimation. Here, of course, different pairs are more favorable in the velocity estimation because, as I explained before, velocity and range estimations have different characteristics. And you can see, for example, here, especially TX3 is more favorable, which is the FM transmitter, because velocity estimation can be performed actually quite well using FM signals. So I think, so far I have explained what I have done in terms of chromaral bands of multistatic multiband radar networks and how we can select the best waveform or the best transmitter receiver pair depending on the target location. So then what can be done in the future? So one of them can be, what is the best receiver location or what are the best receiver locations to maximize the range and velocity estimation accuracies? Because we know that these estimation performance are highly related to location of transmitter, receiver, and target location. So if we can find the best location for receivers, that would be great for estimation. And another question here, instead of selecting the best pair, can we fuse the information obtained from all pairs to maximize the estimation performance? So here, so far, I just considered what is the best pair for any target location. However, we have still information from other pairs as well. If we know this information, okay, this is the best pair, let's say for this location. However, other pairs might provide some information, but with less accuracy. So if you know this information, what is the accuracy of this estimation? This is actually related to chromaral bands. Then we might combine all of this information to maximize the estimation accuracies. So for example, I said one of them could be the impact of the receiver location or selecting the best receiver locations. So here you can see in the same network, just changing the location of this receiver from here to here, the overall estimation accuracies have been improved for range and velocity. For example, here we have some areas with a lower estimation accuracies, and here as well, they are covered. And here, for example, we have a lower estimation accuracy for velocity, which is caused by the bistatic geometry or forward scatter. But when we move this receiver from this point to this point, actually, then we can have a better estimation or overall better estimation accuracy for this area of interest. Okay, thank you very much. I have finished my presentation now. If you have any questions or suggestions, I think we can discuss now. Thank you.